Good afternoon, everybody. So in the last lecture, we were trying to discuss how neutron can be used to characterize the material, especially how it can be used to characterize the magnetic structure. Before I go in this elastic magnetic scattering, in the last lecture, there was a doubt that when you do this neutron powder neutron diffraction study or neutron diffraction study, what is the source of background? So if you see neutron nucleus interaction, so this differential scattering cross section is given by this ensemble average of B of R exponential iota Q dot R. Now here B is the scattering length. And this scattering length depends on the element, it depends on the isotope, it depends on the combined spin state of neutron nucleus system. So for the nucleus having spin I, I can write total spin as I plus half and I minus half. Now total number of states for the spin I plus half becomes 2I plus half plus 1, and the number of states with the spin I minus half become 2I minus half plus 1. And the scattering length for this two configurations are B plus and B minus. Now I can write this differential scattering cross section like BR, BR prime, and exponential iota QR minus R prime. This was covered, I believe, in the last lecture. Now assume once you have a sample, in the sample you have isotopes and this nuclear spins. And this isotopes and this spins, they are uncorrelated and they are randomly distributed in your sample. So I can write this summation B of R prime as these two factors. So here what I am writing is average scattering length, which is nothing but summation of, so this is the concentration of that particular isotope, and 4i plus 2 becomes total number of states, as you can see from here. So 2i plus 1 plus 1, 2i plus 2, and this is 2i. So it becomes 4i plus 2. So the weighted factor for the state with this configuration is 2i plus 2 divided by this total number of state. And this is the scattering length for this configuration. And similarly, I can write for the other configuration, which is I minus half. With this way, what you can decompose your d sigma over d omega in this two part. So this first part is telling us this depends on the Q, and the other part do not depend on the Q. So the first part, which depends on the Q, has finite value only if you do this summation, then you find that the first term has finite value only when your momentum transfer vector become one of the reciprocal lattice vector. So here K, I am denoting as one of the reciprocal lattice vector, nuclear reciprocal lattice vector to be specific. So this first term depend on the direction and magnitude of Q. But as you can see, this second term, this term has no dependence on Q. So if you take a diffraction pattern of a sample, then you will find at each place, means at, like suppose if you are recording with one dimension detector, then you will find for all values of 2 theta, the second term remains same. So this second term gives rise to the background which is called incoherent scattering, and this term is same in all direction, means it has no q dependence. So this is the source of background in case of neutron nucleus interaction. So the part summary is this: the average scattering length in your sample gives the coherent scattering, and the deviation from the average, which is written here b square average minus b average square, give you the incoherent scattering. And this incoherent scattering is same in all the direction. Now we were discussing in the last lecture, now what are the implications of this? So as you can see, I have written here the value of coherent and incoherent scattering cross section for a couple of nuclei. So you can see this hydrogen has huge incoherent scattering cross section. So if you have sample in which you have hydrogen, so you will find lot of background when you do the neutron scattering experiment. Now one can see here that the for vanadium, this coherent scattering cross section is very, very small. However, it has finite, not very large, incoherent scattering cross section. For aluminium, there's an interesting phenomena that it has some small coherent scattering cross section, but it has zero incoherent scattering cross section. And these values of this coherent and incoherent scattering cross section you can find on the website of NIST. Now, what are the implications of these coherent and incoherent scattering cross sections when you do the neutron scattering experiment? So last time I told you that when you do the neutron scattering experiment, you put your sample in a can. This can is made of aluminum, vanadium, and this can has cylindrical shape, and the height of can is something like 4 to 5 cm, and diameter depends on how much sample you have, so something like 6 to 8 mm. Now question comes, why we have chosen this vanadium can to carry out this neutron diffraction experiment? So the answer of this question lies here. You see, if you put your sample in the vanadium can, then what you have here is you have almost zero coherent scattering cross section. So when you do the neutron scattering experiment or neutron powder diffraction experiment, if the vanadium is in the beam, then it will not give any additional peak in your diffraction pattern. Like suppose if you want to put iron can in your for your sample, then what you will feel is that this iron has finite coherent scattering cross section. So in your diffraction pattern, what you will find is, let me use the, so if you record this diffraction pattern, which is intensity versus 2 theta, so if you put your sample in the vanadium can, then you will find here peak associated with your sample only, because sigma coherent for vanadium is zero. So you are not going to get any elastic peak from the vanadium sample holder. But this vanadium has finite okay. So as I was trying to explain you that if you try to do a neutron diffraction experiment and you want to determine magnetic structure of a sample where you have suppose copper or spin 1/2, now the intensity in the neutron diffraction goes as सो इंटेंसिटी, मैग्नेटिक इंटेंसिटी इज प्रोपोर्शनल टू एस स्क्वायर. सो सपोज यू आर डीलिंग विद द स्पिन वन हाफ सिस्टम, देन योर मैग्नेटिक इंटेंसिटी इज एक्सपेक्टेड टू बी स्मॉल एंड यू कैन नॉट अफोर्ड द बैकग्राउंड फ्रॉम द वेनेडियम कैन. सो व्हाट यू कैन डू इन दोज कंडीशन इज दैट इंस्टेड ऑफ पुटिंग योर सैंपल इन द वेनेडियम कैन, यू कैन पुट योर सैंपल इन द एल्यूमिनियम कैन. बट यू नो दिस एल्यूमिनियम हैज फाइनाइट कोहरेंट स्कैटरिंग क्रॉस सेक्शन, सो ड्यू टू विच यू आर गोइंग टू गेट ए पीक कोरस्पॉन्डिंग टू द एल्यूमिनियम होल्डर, एल्यूमिनियम सैंपल होल्डर इन योअर डिफ्रेक्शन पैटर्न. बट यू नो अबाउट दिस क्रिस्टल स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ एल्यूमिनियम, सो यू कैन इजिली पुट दिस पीक वाइल डूइंग द रिफाइनमेंट ऑफ दिस डाटा बिकॉज यू नो दिस डी स्पेसिंग ऑफ द एल्यूमिनियम. सो यू नो एट विच वैल्यू ऑफ 2 थीटा दिस एल्यूमिनियम इज गोइंग टू गिव यू द इलास्टिक पीक. बट द इंपॉर्टेंट पार्ट हियर इज दिस, व्हेन यू आर पुटिंग योर सैंपल इन द एल्यूमिनियम दिस इनकोहेरेंट स्कैटरिंग क्रॉस सेक्शन इज जीरो. सो द बैकग्राउंड इन योर डिफ्रेक्शन पैटर्न विल बी वेरी वेरी स्मॉल, सो इट विल बी वेरी स्मूथ बैकग्राउंड, सो यू कैन इजिली सी दिस मैग्नेटिक सिग्नल. सो व्हेन यू डू दिस न्यूट्रॉन स्कैटरिंग एक्सपेरिमेंट यू शुड बी अवेयर अबाउट दिस फैक्ट्स. So this was the question from last time. Now let me start the part. So we were trying to deal this elastic magnetic neutron scattering. So in the elastic magnetic neutron scattering, this d sigma over d omega has these three major components. This is the magnetic scattering length square. This is polarization factor. So this polarization factor ensures you that you are seeing only the component of the moment which is transverse to the cube. And here is nothing but it is the magnetic structure factor. And what this delta function is telling you is that you will get the magnetic break peak when your momentum transfer Q becomes one of the magnetic reciprocal lattice factor. But before you do or you want to analyze this magnetic scattering, first one has to get a fair idea about the crystal structure. So let us start with this, how this diffraction pattern, in the power diffraction pattern, how you can calculate the intensity from this nuclear phase. So what I write here is, so diffraction pattern can be calculated so I can write intensity or the calculated intensity at position I as sum of phi s of phi sum over h I phi h omega of theta. Suppose you are recording your diffraction pattern as a function of theta, then theta phi of h plus v. So this is the calculated intensity you have. Here s phi, so what I am assuming here that in your sample there are couple of phases. So s phi is nothing but it is the scale factor for the phase. And omega is your profile function. So this depends both on your instrument and your sample effect. Now, this calculated intensity is the sum of these different phases, and this is the scale factor for that particular phase, and this is the intensity, and this is the profile function, and H represent here the back reflection. So H here is H in the last expression was Bragg reflection. Now your intensity I, it depends on the factor which is called multiplicity. So I for powder diffraction multiplicity, it depends on the Lorentz polarization factor, and what you have is the structure factor. So your intensity depends on these three factors. So multiplicity, my mean is that suppose you are recording a powder diffraction pattern, so all the reflections for which the d values are same, they are going to appear at the same q value, at the same 2 theta value. So let's say if you have a simple cubic structure, and suppose you are recording intensity as a function of 2 theta, and suppose this is the 100 peak, then what you will find is that the d spacing for the 100 in the case of cubic system 0 1 0 0 0 1 1 bar 0 0 0 1 bar 0 0 0 1 bar. So the d value for all these six reflection is same. So all these six reflections are going to give the peak at the same location. So the multiplicity for this peak become 6. So Lorentz, the second factor which affects the intensity is the Lorentz factor. Which in the case of neutrons becomes 1 upon sin 2 theta. And the third factor which you have in the intensity is the structure factor square, which is nothing but Vj exponential 2 pi iota hx plus ky plus lz and square. So these are the factors on which your intensity depends. So when you do the Ritwald refinement, what you try to do is you try to calculate this diffraction pattern by using the formula which I told you. So you calculate this y c of I by using this formula. S of phi is the scale factor, I is the intensity, this is the sum over all H, and this is the peak profile function, which is, let's say you are measuring your experiment as a function of 2 theta. So you can calculate this pattern as a function of theta or 2 theta, and this is h plus vector. And now the idea is to minimize this chi square, which is nothing but sum of I equal to 1, weight of that particular point y observed minus y calculated I, and this calculated intensity is a function of this structural parameter of your sample, and this parameter you can refine, and then the idea is to minimize the chi square to refine this crystal structure. So by doing this method, you trying to refine the crystal structure. Now let's come to the point of this magnetic structure. So you know, this in your sample, once you have this magnetic moment, so there are two kind of energy scales. One is the thermal energy, which is given by this KBT. So your thermal energy, which is given by KBT, and another is the exchange energy, which depends on the exchange interaction, and this exchange energy determines your Curie-Weiss temperature of your magnetic sample. So if the thermal energy is greater than the exchange energy, then what you have is the paramagnetic state of the sample, and if you are at sufficiently low temperature, means you are much below than the theta Cw, then your exchange energy dominates over thermal energy, and what you get is the ordered structure like this. And this moment in your sample can arrange in a couple of ways. So there can be like simple kind of magnetic ordering, like ferromagnetic order, where your all moments in your unit cell are aligned in some particular direction. So you have net magnetization in the sample. You can have antiferromagnetic ordering, so where this net moment in the unit cell is zero. You can have ferrimagnetic ordering, where this net magnetic moment is not zero. So you have a up moment and down moment, but they cannot cancel with each other. So still you have the finite moment. And nowadays there are a couple of systems where you have the frustration in the system, like triangular lattice or so. There you can have a couple of fine exotic states. You can have tented magnetic ground state. So here you have antiferromagnet, but you have some net ferromagnetic component also in certain direction. So how do you proceed to determine the magnetic structure of your sample? So neutron, as you know, is quite expensive technique. So before you do the neutron diffraction experiment, once you synthesize your sample, first you would like to do this X-ray diffraction experiment. And once you know that you have made this phase pure sample, then your next idea is to carry out magnetization measurement. And this magnetization can tell you, it can give an idea about this ordering temperature of your system. So something like you can measure magnetization as a function of temperature. If you have antiferromagnet, you can have magnetization as a function of, so this is ferromagnet, and you can record the magnetization, and then what you can do is you can plot chi inverse as a function of temperature, and you can get this kind of curves. So by fitting this curve, they can give the idea about this Curie-Weiss temperature. So this Curie-Weiss temperature tell you that this energy scales of the exchange interaction of your problem, but it do not tell you that. It can only tell you, like, if this theta Cw is positive, that because this theta Cw is combined effect of all sorts of exchange interaction in your sample. So theta Cw positive only gives you idea that dominant exchange interaction in your sample is ferromagnetic, or if the theta Cw is negative, then you can tell that dominant exchange interaction in my sample is antiferromagnetic. But it did not give any idea about the magnetic structure, means how the moments are arranged in your sample. So the idea is, once you have determined this ordering Curie-Weiss temperature by measuring the magnetization of the system, then what you do is to determine this magnetic structure, like how this spins, atomic spins are arranged in your sample, what you do is you go to a neutron diffractometer, you try to analyze, or you plan to carry out neutron diffraction experiments. So the idea is, when you carry out neutron diffraction experiment, is to determine this different kind of magnetic structure of your samples. So they can be simple magnetic structure, you can have helical kind of magnetic structure, or ferro or ferrimagnetic magnetic kind of structure. Now the question comes, how you define this magnetic structure. Now before I go to this business of propagation vector, that how you define this magnetic structure, let me tell you, let us just evaluate this magnetic structure factor for a couple of the simple magnetic structures. So let's take this let's say again I take this one dimension lattice. And my magnetic structure factor, I can write it as sum of, let's say, spin I and exponential iota q dot t or q dot r. Now suppose this material orders in a ferromagnetic structure. So here SI is plus or minus depending on whether, let's say, spin is along z direction or minus z direction. So this is structure F. So like if your ferromagnet, and let's say suppose this is the unit cell, then suppose if I calculate, I'm in the only one direction, so f of 0 is nothing but your s plus this another atom. So now what you see is this, your magnetic reciprocal lattice vector is same as your nuclear reciprocal lattice vector. But suppose now you go to this antiferromagnetic business, then what you have is this spins are aligned in opposite direction. So this is my magnetic unit cell, which is 2a. So my magnetic reciprocal lattice vector is 2pi by 2a, which is pi by a. So I will get this peak, which are additional peak in the diffraction pattern, if I record the diffraction pattern below this ordering temperature for a ferromagnet. So suppose this is 2 pi by A, this is 4 pi by A. So here I will get this additional peak, which is at pi by A, 3 pi by A, due to this higher periodicity of this magnetic unit cell. So let's take this two dimension case now. Let's take this simplest lattice, which is the square lattice, and let's try to understand how we can calculate this magnetic structure. So this is square lattice. Let me show it slightly. And suppose this is antiferromagnetic structure. So here is the spin plus, minus, this becomes minus, and this becomes plus, plus, minus, minus. Now let me write down this structure factor. So if I write F, which is QH, QK, which is nothing but sum of this, all these four atoms, S exponential iota Q dot R. Now suppose you have an antiferromagnetic structure, and suppose this is the X A direction and this is the B direction. Now let us calculate this structure factor for this configuration for the gamma point, which is 0 0. So F of 0 0 is nothing but S exponential iota Q is 0 0 dot R is 0 0 plus Q dot, and then R is 1 0 plus S exponential similarly 0 0 and 0 1, and fourth term will be S So due to this 0 0, what we have is, sorry, there's a mistake which I have made. So this is 0 0, then this has to be minus, because this spin is in this G direction, this is minus G, this is plus, and the fourth one is. So magnetic structure factor for this point is 0. So means if you have this kind of magnetic structure in the square lattice, you will not get any peak at this gamma point, this 0 0 point. Similarly, you can calculate that if your Q vector is, let us say, around 1 0, then again you can do this summation, and what you will find again is that this term is 0. So, but if you do this summation for this point, which is F of, means half, then you will find all these four term adds currently, and what you get is S half, half, and this is 0, 0, plus all this 4 pi. So we'll find that the magnetic structure factor for this becomes 4s. But now here, this is your A, this is your B, and what I try to show here is that this is your magnetic structure. This is down, this has to be up. I can extend this unit cell, so this is down, this has to be up. This is up, so this has to be down. So this is down, this has to be up. This is up, this has to be down. This is down, so this has to be up. So my Q vector now is along this direction. So I'm measuring this reflection, which is half up. So this intensity which I see in this magnetic neutron diffraction is also governed by the polarization factor. So let's try to evaluate this polarization factor, which in this case is 1 minus so this is polarization factor. Now here eta is this unit vector along the direction of the spin, and q is this direction of your momentum transfer vector. So q here is half half. So I can write it here is the angle between this spin direction and the direction of your momentum transfer vector. So this is, suppose the angle is cos theta, then this vector becomes cos square theta. And what you see is sine square, this angle is alpha. So what you see here is a so your intensity now will depend on this polarization factor also. So the intensity for this F half half, this half of reflection becomes square of this, which is 4s square into cos, sorry, sine square 45, because the angle between my moment direction and my reciprocal lattice vector is 45 degrees, and this gives rise to 16s square into sine square 45 is 0.5, so 8s square. Now suppose if you have this kind of magnetic structure and you want to measure any reflection which is along a direction, let's suppose your moment is aligned along this a direction and you want to measure all sort of this reflection, 1 0, 2 0, or half zero. So in this case your direction of moment is in the direction of q. So what you will find is, due to this polarization factor, you will find your intensity is zero. So please always keep this in mind when you want to do this neutron diffraction experiment, that you are only sensitive to the component of the moment which is transfers to your q vector. Now let us see. So let us see this reciprocal lattice, how it looks for the your nuclear cell and the magnetic cell. for the case of square lattice. So suppose so I'm trying to make reciprocal lattice for a square. So suppose these are the reflections corresponding to your nuclear break peak. So it means I can denote them as your P1 star or let us see P2 star. So these are the reciprocal lattice vector of your sample. Now, as you know, now your magnetic unit cell is double of your nuclear unit cell in both direction. So your magnetic reciprocal lattice vectors become smaller. So these are my, sorry, let me use different color. So here I will find my magnetic break peaks. So my magnetic reciprocal lattice vector in each direction is, suppose this is M, this is AM, and suppose this is BM. So as you can see, my magnetic reciprocal lattice vector is half of my nuclear reciprocal lattice vector. So please keep this thing in the mind when you are dealing with the magnetic structure, that when you have antiferromagnetic ordering, in general your magnetic unit cell becomes larger than your nuclear cell and your reciprocal cell becomes smaller. Now let us see how we can define the magnetic structure or the moment in a sample. So easiest way to define this magnetic structure is you define moment as a projection along this three crystallographic direction, and you can define with you can define then the magnetic unit cell with respect to your nuclear cell. Well, it is possible if you have a simplest kind of magnetic structures like ferromagnetic, antiferromagnetic, or antiferromagnetic with a wave vector half half or 1/3, 1/3. But sometimes when you have incommensurate kind of a structure, it becomes difficult to describe this magnetic structure in this method. Then what we take the help of this propagation vector. So then we define this magnetic structure based on the description on the nuclear unit cell and a propagation vector which describes the relation between the orientation of the magnetic moment located in the equally magnetic sites in different nuclear cell and how we define this propagation vector. So this is the simplest case. Let's assume, so how we define moment is, we define moment as a sum of Sk. This Sk are this Fourier components and K is the propagation vector, and this Fourier component of this moment, they can be written as a summation of this basis vector. We will learn in this next lecture probably that how one can determine this basis vector for the magnetic ordering. So I can define this magnetic moment as Sk, which is the Fourier component of the moment, and exponential minus iota k dot r, r is the position. Let's say suppose we have this kind of magnetic structure. So this is the direction of this spin. So this Sk here is the Fourier component, which I define as a 0, 1, 0. Now k, suppose in this case is 0, 0, half. then I can write this magnetic structure 0 0 half multiply by RL is 0 0 0. This becomes the same. Now I go this position which is 0 0 1, then SK is again 0 1 0 exponential minus 2 pi minus K is 0 0 half, and this RL is now 0 0 1, and you can multiply this factor, and what you will find is the minus sign. This moment is reversed. If you go to this 0 0 2 position, then again you find that this exponential factor become 1. So this moment is in the same direction as the 0 0 0, and this is how you can define this magnetic moment, magnetic structure. And as these moments are real, so this, for the moment to be real, this Fourier component SK and this Fourier component which is associated with this propagation vector minus K, this conjugate and this should be equal, because this summation is over all this propagation vector of your unit set. Now, how we define this commensurate or incommensurate vector? Suppose I have the propagation vector where the P, Q and R are rational number. Then I call something like half, 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 0, 0, 1/3, 1/3, 1/3, or 1/4, 0, 0. So these kind of structures are called commensurate magnetic structures. You have incommensurate structure where this P, Q, R are not rational numbers, they are irrational numbers. Then you, this taking the help of this propagation vector is very useful. And this is how I can write then this magnetic structure. So here SK, as I told you, is the Fourier coefficient and K is the propagation vector. Now, how we can describe this magnetic structure? So ML is nothing but SK minus exponential iota K dot R, and this exponential factor can be written as cos K minus iota sin K. And suppose K is 0, 0, 0 or half 0, 0. Now I have to take the sum over all these K vectors, means K and minus K. Then what I see here, ML, it's S L K minus iota exponential K dot R plus this another K, which is minus of this K. So I find this moment is sinusoidal with respect to R. So this is amplitude modulated structure. So this is how we define this magnetic structure. So now this is the definition how we define this magnetic structure. Now let's come to the point that how we determine the magnetic structure by using neutron diffraction. So before I go to this, let us just take this practical advantage of the neutron. So without going into the detail of this system has two crystallographic location for the cobalt. One is this trigonal prism and another is the octahedron. Now suppose if we substitute this iron with the cobalt, and now first idea before doing this magnetic neutron diffraction studies, to determine or to find out the crystal structure of the sample. So first we have to find it out. Let's assume that where is the iron going in this sample. Now, can we use the X-ray? You know, in the case of X-ray, this intensity is proportional to your form factor square, and form factor is directly proportional to Z. So it is very difficult to distinguish between cobalt and iron by using X-ray, because they differ in Z by 1. But in the case of neutron, this neutron nucleus scattering length, there is no systematic dependence, and by using neutron, you can tell the iron in this compound where it is going. So by doing neutron diffraction experiment, what we find is that this iron in this compound goes to this trigonal prism side. So this is the beauty of neutron in the part of crystal structure refinement. So here I show the crystal structure of this compound. So there are two sides of the cobalt, And in the octahedral side, as you know, there is a T2G and EG splitting. So cobalt do not carry moment, and it carries the magnetic moment in the one of the side. And by doing this neutron diffraction, we can tell that the iron in this compound or in this material is going to trigonal prism side. Now, our idea was to determine this magnetic structure. So as I told you, now from this neutron diffraction experiment, which was carried out at room temperature, we know where this iron is going. And before doing neutron, what we do is we carry out X-ray diffraction experiment and try to find out its crystal structure. And then to determine this magnetic ordering, first step is to go to a magnetometer and try to record magnetization. So this chi inverse versus T tells me that my Curie-Weiss temperature is of the order of something like 30 K. So it still do not tell me anything about the magnetic ordering. But it tells me that if I have to do this neutron diffraction experiment to determine the magnetic structure of this material, then I should at least go to the temperature which is something like half of this theta Curie-Weiss. So something like I should do the experiment below 15 to 20 K. And this is what I'm trying to show the result of this one of this sample. So what you see here is this neutron diffraction pattern as a function of temperature. So these are this experiment at couple of temperature. And what you see here is that as you go to the low temperature, something like 16 K or so, there is an appearance of this additional peak. The appearance of this additional peak means you have some sort of magnetic ordering. And now the idea behind this neutron diffraction is to determine this microscopic structure, means we have to determine this static spin-spin correlation in this material. Now we will come to this point. Now, how we proceed that to do this part? So as an experimentalist, what we do is we collect this neutron powder diffraction pattern at couple of temperature below the ordering temperature. So means to determine your Curie-Weiss temperature and go as below as you can go below this Curie-Weiss temperature. And okay, so let me repeat again. So how do you start with the determining the magnetic structure of your material? So first you go to magnetometer and try to determine what can be this Curie-Weiss temperature of your material. And then collect this neutron, NPD is here, neutron powder diffraction pattern. And collect the neutron powder diffraction pattern below and about the magnetic ordering temperature. So idea is you collect couple of this neutron powder diffraction pattern and then find it out that whether you are getting some additional peak or you are getting some enhancement in the intensity of your fundamental nuclear reflection. Then the next idea is to determine this propagation vector of this magnetic ordering. What one can do is to determine this propagation vector or K vector of this magnetic ordering is you take the neutron diffraction pattern in the paramagnetic phase, means when the system is not ordered, and you take this neutron diffraction pattern at the best temperature and you try to take this difference between these two pattern. And when you take the difference between these two pattern, what you will get is you will get that the location of Q values or 2 theta value where you are getting enhancement in the intensity. So means you know at which location in the reciprocal space you have magnetic peaks. And then you determine this little group of K, which I will come in this next lecture, GK, and determine its irreducible representation. Now, this k vector determination, once you know the location of in your powder diffraction pattern, that these are the q values where you have enhancement in the intensity of nuclear reflection, then there is a program in the wind plotter, this k search program, and I will tell you in the next lecture how using this k search program you can find out the propagation vector. You can find out by your paper and pen also. And then you try to determine what are the symmetry allowed magnetic structure and try to fit your observed intensity, and you will find out of this many allowed symmetry allowed magnetic structure, one of this fits your neutron diffraction pattern. So the idea of the q vector here is, so so when you are magnetic ordering, you will get the reflection in the reciprocal space at the location which is determined by this h plus e. So something like, suppose you have the square lattice and k is suppose half, then this is reciprocal lattice vector which is 0, 0. So if you have the magnetic ordering in the square lattice by this propagation vector half, then you will find the magnetic peak at this location. So you find out the position of the q values at which you have the additional peak, and with this relation you can determine what is this propagation vector of this additional magnetic peaks. Now let's start some practical let me start with a very simple example for this. Okay, this is the detailed structure which I will come in the next lecture. So this is the another recent experiment which we carried out. Here you, what you see is that as you reduce the temperature, like below temperature something like 120K or so, you find there is an enhancement in the intensity. Now this enhancement in the intensity in the top of your fundamental nuclear reflection, this gives you the idea that the magnetic structure either is ferromagnetic or it is ferrimagnetic. Then by doing this detailed analysis, we found that it is ferrimagnetic. Now let's see how we proceed with this system. So quickly I will show you, then I will so I think you know about this program, which is full prop suit. I think every one of you can download this program from the ILL website. I can show it to you. So okay, you type in the Google ILL full prop, then depending on your system you can install this program. Now here what I show you is that how you see this data file. So I can select this input directory. So I am selecting this data directory, let's say, and I, so this, when you do this ritual refinement, what you have is a, once you have this data file, and this data file can be in any format. The data file which I am having right now is so this file is that file. So you see this is in the XY format. So now you go to the full prof and open this window, Winplot R2006. Let me reset it and let's see this data file first. So let me plot all this data which we are having. So this is 300K. This is in the format XY sigma. There are different format which you can choose. So first is the free format, where what you have is the starting point, step and end point, and then your column vector which defines your intensity. So this is the diffraction pattern at 300. Now let me plot to show you how in real life. 180 180 देन आई हैव 160 140 and I have 100. And from this magnetization, we knew that this magnetic ordering temperature should be around 120 or 130 K. And I have plotted up to 100 K. Now I plot it. Next data point is 75 K. And after this, I have 5. So here I have plotted all this data. Now you can see it as I am reducing this temperature. So there is an enhancement in the intensity of some of this reflection. And now this enhancement is at the same location where I have the peak in the paramagnetic phase. I think time is over. We can stop for this part for the day. And we will continue from this full proof program in the next lecture. So our idea in the next class will be, we will start first with this nuclear part and then come to the magnetic part and see how we can determine the magnetic structure. So next lecture will be on Monday. And now I stop for this 2 days lecture. But if you have any query, you can type it or send the email. I think you know the email address. Okay. I also wish you a very happy Diwali, which is tomorrow, and I hope you will enjoy this Diwali. And then we will meet on Monday at the same time, 3 o'clock, and then we will learn with this actual data which was collected recently on this Newton powder diffractometer at Dhruva, then how we can determine the magnetic structure from this Newton diffraction data. Goodbye. Okay. See you on Monday then at the same time.